Hi, and welcome to this tutorial where I'll be showing you how to create an animal completely from scratch for Zoo Tycoon 2 using the program Blender. And our subject will be the thylacine or Tasmanian tiger. And as you can see here, I've collected quite an assembly of images from the web, and also I've taken some stills from the video footage that is available, and this will help us in creating the model properly as it should look, and later on create animations and make it as accurate as possible. So first of all, we have to get a proper side view of our model we have to get a proper side view of the thylacine to be able to create a proper model. So there was a problem where there wasn't really anyone that had a proper side pose. So this one was like looking to the side, and this one, the first one, was a bit distorted, and the other one was hidden behind the first one. So what I did was to combine these two, and to keep the proportions clear, I've lined them up together and matched them. So now we have a really nice side view, and then I cut out the background, so this will make lining up the model later on easy in Blender, so you don't have to check every time where the model ends. Like in this area, it's hard to tell, so it's best if you fix that right away. So now background is gone, and also if we're already at it, we can layer into this image our skeleton, and we will need that one later on when we create our armature in Blender, so the skeleton of our model. And for this I used one skeleton I found on Google, and changed the pose slightly so it matches and lined up as good as possible. Of course, you don't have to do that, but if you don't know anatomy really well, you would have to know where the bones are placed in order to create a proper armature. And you can see it lines up really well in terms of proportions. So that also shows us that the first step was done correctly. You can see the skull. It's accurately sized, and it looks pretty good. Okay, so now we're ready to get into Blender and open it. So this is an empty scene. If yours is not empty, just make it empty. Okay, so the first thing you want to do is you add a plane and at the center, so Shift C and spacebar. Add plane, add mesh plane. You can see the commands I'm using at the lower corner, lower left corner. So I'm not going to say them out loud all the time. So if you can't follow, you can look at those keystrokes. Okay. So we are now at top view. And we want to bring the plane into the side layer, and we move it a bit to the side, and now we go to side view, and there we have our plane. Okay, so this will be our reference image, so we can bring it up a little here and make it smaller and give it a proper format. So now we unwrap it and swap to text strip view and create a little UV window and select it and load an image. And where is it? Okay, yeah, so I will use this silhouette that I've created, and now the format is different, so unwrap again, and we got to make it a little longer, so unwrap again, and even more. Okay, that looks good. Now if we want to be really fancy, we can go to texture face, draw type, and set on to two side and clip alpha, and copy and copy, and now this is cut out, so this is not really needed, but it makes it nice to see. Okay, so you may be used to using the preview image, but this has the disadvantage that when you turn your viewpoint, you lose the image. But when you use this texture plane, it's always there. So this makes it really nice to have the reference all the time. And of course, you can also add in more than one plane, and have one for the side, one for the front, and one for the top, for example. Okay, so now we add a second image, this time front. So we go to front and make sure we're in object mode, add a plane and make it face the front, unwrap it again and open our desired image. Okay, so this time it's a still from one of those movie clips, and was the best that I could find. So make sure it's centered, and now comes an important part, and here we have to line it up to the side view. So we bring the side view back to the middle, and we take this one and make the match as good as possible, because the better the match is here, the easier it will be later on to model the model straight away in one flow, basically, without getting stopped by having to combine the images. So now we can go to the front and then shift a bit to the back. It has to be a little smaller because it has to line up as good as possible. So you see here the top of the head lines up rather well, and the ears also, and now the eyes are fine too, and the nose is still a bit off, so a little bit smaller, and now it looks pretty good. And center it again, make sure it's really centered properly, because otherwise you will get the animal stretched or too thick or too thin. Okay, so now those are our references for now, and we can begin with the actual modeling. I didn't take a top view because I don't think it's really necessary. We can maybe incorporate one later if we need to, but by default, if it's a quadruped, you usually don't need a top reference. You can mostly base it on estimates or guesses, and also the shading usually tells you where you have to move in or out. Okay, so now we add a third model, and this time this will be our actual model. So add mesh. Let's take a cube, it doesn't really matter. Okay, so first of all we delete everything. Oh, we scale it down to one vertex because we want to have just one to start with, and remove doubles, and then we have one point and we can start modeling from that one. So now it's quite tricky because we the reference image is quite low resolution, and especially for modeling details this is not optimal, and so we'll have to pay great attention to our vertex flow and how we add details and where. So we'll also have to look at other images to make sure it's accurate. So we can start now by extruding around the edges. So basically first thing is to follow the actual outline. So now this is nice because we already have sort of an outline, because we have this nicely clean cutout from the alpha. So whenever the curves are like sharp, you add more detail, and when they are straight lines, you can leave out more detail. Okay, so now this jaw. So already think about how you want to structure your lips later on, because this makes quite a difference how you model them, and also when you have intersections like these, keep that in mind and remember which one you want to use where. And make sure that you have those connections already kind of arranged, so you can place face loops there later on more easily. And you can have stuff like this. Okay, so that's enough for here. Also here. So I'm really just extruding it and following the lines. And first I do this just from one side, and then now when I have some idea of where I have to go, I can go to the front view and make it, bring it out, so not quite from the front, but like kind of from the front, because in the front it's all in one. Yes, so bring it out and give it this shape, and now you can see from the front. Now we can line it up. Like this. And we can already add a mirror modifier. And this will then show us the mirrored results. Okay, and I think we better move this one out again so we can see our midline clearly. Back. Straight out. So, okay. Okay, another nice trick, we can use this for loop tool and connected for loop. So when we scroll, we can change the influence size of the for loop. And this is quite useful for stuff like this, where we have to move those points out a bit. And turn it off. Okay, so now you see the mouth doesn't line up extremely well, so we'll have to do some guesswork, and that looks kinda accurate. Not quite, but this will do, I think, more or less. Oh, and activate clipping so you don't move your middle vertices out of the middle plane. So then now they're fixed. Oh, and deactivated because the ear has to be moved out. So we can use clipping. We can use the for loop again. And this usually makes it quicker than if you would move every single vertice on its own. You see, I didn't touch them all, only some of it. Okay, so now we've got a little topology problem because we didn't see the difference between this and the distance between ear and middle. So we'll subdivide it and bring it to the appropriate place. And now you can see, you can already guess where we are heading to. So it's beginning to take shape. Okay, so now we can make sure that it aligns more nicely. So sometimes we'll have to make compromises against the different possible views. So we'll have to get the average and move it so it looks good from all sides and not just good from one. Because in the end, you hardly ever look at it from straight front or straight back. So it's really more important that it has a good feel and looks good from all directions. And now you see the ears are smoother and more nicely looking curves. Okay, so yeah, we'll just continue with the ears because those are relatively easy. Okay, so now you see we have those areas here where we're simply going to extrude the whole part. And oh yeah, now we're getting this problem. So we'll have to go to Object tab and change the draw type of our model to wireframe. And now we can see what's behind it again. Okay, so we can now move those out a bit, out of the layer using Alt S. So this will, okay, this doesn't really work yet. This will scale them along their normals and move them outside. So, kind of like this. Okay, and these ones we can delete these. And here, merge them a bit. And remove doubles. And from the side. Okay, so you can see where we're going here. Could do one more extruding round and bring them to the center a bit, and now move them inwards. One more. Okay, now this isn't really nice topology, so we can remove a few to make it look better. Like this. So you try to save as many points wherever we can. Okay, so we triangulate this one, rotate it there, and we have this, the inner ear, it has to move down here, obviously, and we can, this one, we can also move this one in. Now when we turn on to shaded mode and set to soft, smooth, and recalculate the normals, and we can see this already looks quite like a model we're used to seeing. Now we can move these here, maybe add one point here, and now we've got a relatively nice topology, and we can continue that on the back side. Of course we don't have as much reference void, but we don't even need it because nobody really looks at the backside of the ear, and nobody knows how it looks, so we can simply guess how it could look, as long as it looks plausible, nobody will care how we made it. So again, we want to get to a nice topology. So we want to get a good flow here. And remove anything we don't really need. And then make it follow the curves so it looks nicely. Okay, that looks pretty good. And now we've got our ears done, more or less at least. You can refine them later on, but we've got the basic shape nailed down. And now you can also combine basically the information you've got on your image and try to also make it match up with the mirrored version. So interpolate between the two to to get a new, more plausible result. You see this ear is a little rounder, so this one was turned probably, so we can scale it a bit using our for loop tool, and now we've got a better average mean of both ears. It's always better than just focusing one. Okay. Now we can go on maybe with draw. So again, we'll use extruding here. And I will again normal scaling. And add this face here. We've already got the first row of our draw now, and we want to make sure this flows well into the rest of the head topology, because we want to get a flow that goes somehow, it follows the natural lines that we see in the face. So we see this line that we have in the down the eye, and we have the line along the jawbone, and here you can see prominently we've got the brows, those are really prominent, and so we want to incorporate all those anatomical details into our polygon structure. So this is our aim for now. And first we continue with the snout a bit. And always compared with the other one. And the next part. You can see it doesn't always look the same, so it's not a cylinder, but at the beginning or at the bottom it's wider at the back, and at the top side it's wider at the front, so the muzzle is wider at the top somehow. Sometimes you just have to follow your references and don't think about the shape too much, because it can confuse you. Okay, now we've come to a point where it doesn't line up exactly with what we had in mind before, so we make it fit somehow. So like this, and maybe we can add another loop here. Move it a bit. Now we've got good topology, but we got to make this one line up. Okay, so we go back to wireframe, and then you can see it's not exactly centered here. So now it looks better, and then we can make this one more slender, the whole thing a little bit more. Now I think we're pretty good. Might be a little too slender here. Yeah, that looks pretty accurate. Okay, so now the nose. So I'm not really sure how the nose exactly looks, so I'll just make it up and imagine it looks like a cat nose or dog nose. Might not be 100% accurate, but I don't have any reference for it, so it's a legitimate guess. And we can follow the lines, so it looks quite similar, actually. So we move this one in, this one out, this one in, like this, and extrude. Can add one more ring here. Okay, so this doesn't really, this image doesn't really give us any piece to how we should make it look. The side reveals a bit of the structure, but not really much. So we can go, I'm guessing, to and try to make, create something that looks plausible and reasonable. And keep in mind to create a topology that looks good and pleasant to the eye. So how can we solve this area here? Yeah, we can subdivide it here. Bring this one out. Make it smooth. And then add one face here, one here, one here, one here. Now does it look good? Might look a bit too much like a dog nose, but we'll see that later on. We can perhaps go back and change it in case we find some more interesting references with more detail on the nose, better resolution. So for the moment it's okay. Okay, so we can move up towards the eye. So we'll try to incorporate all those flows that we've been talking about. And you can see those brows are really prominent here, so we'll actually model them. Okay. So now you have to really think about how the points should flow across the face, because it makes a huge difference if your structure looks good and organic, or if it simply somehow resembles the model but it doesn't really have an inherent structure that looks good. So really put a lot of thought into this process and try to create something that makes sense and follows the main lines. This might do. You see that this brow here is really prominent, so we can go and make it wider and add. Now we can add it later on. And now we line it up from this view. Now we can see that we've got the brow sort of in place. And now we can give this one a little bit extra prominence. Yeah, this looks fine. Okay, now we have to incorporate VI, so we'll just subdivide these, because it's not, the first one was not detailed enough, and now we can get to a better level of detail, because we already know where we're going and how it's supposed to look. Okay. Yeah, that goes in the right direction. So we can take these and extrude them to the center and remove doubles and move it out slightly, not too much, and now bring the whole thing a little to the inside, because it should be sunken beneath the eyes, and we can also bring these ones outside, so we get a nice contrast between both, so it really looks indented and not just flat, because we don't have to add any detail if we don't make use of it. That's the general idea. We can move these out even further and now join this part and give it some nicer topology. And we subdivide this here and move it down to pronounce the brows better. So this puts some emphasis onto that. And we can set smooth, and we calculate the normals, and yeah, well, we're getting there. Okay, so now we can extrude these down here, move them out, and again try to follow our flow, merge these and move it where it belongs. This is in a weird position. Okay, next loop down here. Now you see we're getting some kind of solution where we have to go with our faces, with our edge flows, and we're getting somewhere that looks like a good flow. So we'll have to adjust it a bit. Now we can line it up from the front. once again. Okay, now it looks too fat. Got to move in here and here and here as well. Yeah. Getting there. Slowly but steadily. Okay, so now we can do this area behind the ear, between ear and leg, and brows. And I think they have some kind of indent in the middle here, so we're going to recreate this as well. So bring this one down, bring these up, bring the middle down, and make the faces. Okay, we don't have to be so sparse here. We can add a loop between, just for the sake of getting a nicer topology. Okay, so how do we solve this one here? So we can come from here and give it this kind of loopy structure. This is probably the best way to go, so we'll keep it like that. Now, bring this one out. And you can see there's some kind of this fold, or this the brow still seems to be extending beyond here, so we can maybe still keep that flow inside. Sadly, we don't really see it well here, so we'll have to guess once again where it should go. And I think here's kind of accurate. Okay, so we can subdivide here and add a face here. Bring this one out. Yeah, it looks quite good already. and complete the loop here. Okay, so now we got to watch out where we have to move something in or out. Okay, so this moving this area here below the brow, moving this inside gave us some nice kind of definition for the cheeks, so they're now relatively prominent. I think it looks good. And now we have to add the jaw bone and jaw muscle, because that one is really prominent as well. So we'll have to pay some attention to detail once again here. So this moves way back here. Okay, so we need at least one more loop for this area. And now again, our reference is not ideal to work with for this issue, because it's simply not the perfect angle to look at it. You can hardly see the jaw. I do have another one, but we can again make this up, because we have a nice reference from the side. We can imagine how it's supposed to look. And because we know those, it had huge jaw muscles, we can assume that this area here has to move out, because this is where the muscles are attached to the jawbone, and they move up here to the top of the head. So they have to be in this area, and we move them out. And this gives us pretty good and reasonable model structure. Okay, so and now we're almost ready to create the lower jaw, more or less. Yeah. Okay, so we created the same way like we did with the upper jaw. So we extrude this line and disable clipping. Oh no, we don't have to, it's already moved out. So we keep clipping and we move it a little outside to give it some roundedness, and then we move it down, scale it down, and move it inside. And we don't need much more detail for the lower jaw, because it's the underside and you hardly see it. So we can once again just keep it like this. Triangulate this one so it doesn't do any crap. Okay. Now move these in a little so we get a more rounded shape. Okay. Now we can merge those two parts. Get to a topology structure that we like. I think the lower jaw is supposed to be not as wide as the aperture so we can move it in a bit. And this is always better to do in textured in shaded view, because you see the angles better. Okay, now we have almost got our head done, just some little edges here where we can pronounce the jaw muscle as already suggested earlier by moving in here. And yeah, let's fade it out. Okay, so here, take this one, merge it, and now look where it's going, where it's supposed to be going, and this is pretty much where it should be. Just some little details to bring all the points into their more or less optical position, optimal position for best look from all possible angles. So turn it around often. When you see something that irks your eye, you fix it. Sometimes smooth tool is nice if it's just really minor peaks. Okay. Okay, now we want to get to a straight line, and which we can later on use to extrude the neck from, more or less straight line at least. So we can use these parts from below and the stuff from above, and now we can see it doesn't really follow any shape, the outline of the ear, so we can fix that as well. We want a more or less oval shape. Now we can think if we want to keep these or we don't. We don't in this case, because they're not really necessary and only add up to the vertex count. And now this looks reasonable. So, by now we've got our head model finished, and in the next part we'll continue with other parts of the body. And I hope you liked it and you could follow. And see you next time.